Hey, what's happening, y'all? This is Dame Funk, and I'm in Boiler Room Chat Room. Let's get into it. What's up, Raj? Raj. It's such a pleasure to know you, babe. And the way I do, let me explain. I know our ride is new, but it's just one thing, Boiler Room, I want to say to you. I want to thank you for stepping into my life, yeah. And I promise you, I'll always treat you right. Welcome. Thank you for stepping into my life, Boiler Room. Oh, chat room. I look forward to getting down with you, 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 yeah. What's up, everybody? Thanks for having me. What's up, guys?
Yes.
All right.
I was meant to intro that show, but damn.
Chat.
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 That's the funk, right?
Oh, it's just funk and art and all of that. You know what I'm saying? So.
How do I get the funk?
The funk just comes naturally, man. You know what I'm saying? It's just in you.
But it doesn't to me. So how do I get it?
You got it. You got it.
You're OG with the West Coast scene. Like you've been around a minute, like pre Stone Throw, like talk us through the story.
I consider myself mid-school.
Mid-school.
Not old school or new school, so I'm kind of sandwiched in between certain eras. It came like, you know, in LA, they have something known as the beat scene and you know, and I was doing things before that.
Yeah.
And then before me, it was like, you know, Egyptian Lover and, you know, like the funk era, you know what I'm saying? So, and a lot of the golden era of hip hop is what they call it these days, like Eric B and Rakim and Slick Rick. So I grew up on all that.
Yeah.
But as I ventured off into working a lot of day jobs, as a lot of us have out there, you know, I just got into my music more seriously after session playing.
Do I look silly with these?
Nah, you look cool, but you can give them a break.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I was always buying records and
you've
just,
got a big collection, right?
Oh, yeah, I do.
Like,
yeah.
How big?
The last time I counted, I think it was like 5,000, but that's small. Shit. Well, you know what it is, man? It's like, I have one of those collections where if I blindfolded myself and I picked out a record, it would be something I actually liked. Yeah. So there's a lot of collectors out there that have records that they just,
garbage.
You know, they, yeah, it's like just because they're collectible, they just watch it or look at it and they just jerk off of it. Yeah, I got that record.
Yeah. I guess with you, the way you make music, you play so much of yourself, it's not really sample-based in the same way where a lot of diggers are like, right, I'm going to use that, and even if the record is garbage, there's a sound in that I can do. You build everything yourself from scratch.
Out there, the perception I've heard is like that, oh, he's Mr., you know, keyboard-only guy, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, really? Like, people think that you're like a hater to the...
I don't know if it's necessarily a hater. They just think that I'm so big on championing playing original music that I think that people, I wonder if he's into my sample-based stuff. And I'm like, yeah, I love it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Pete Rock, one of the legends, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He plays and samples so well, and you know, all of those cats that I grew up on. So yeah, I love sample-based music, but from what you're saying, my approach is musical, just straight up original material. I like to say I sample my own mind.
Yeah.
Another misconception is that I have a Jerry curl and I never had one. So this is my natural hair. So let's, misconception number two. No, I'm just kidding.
No, do it. I'm serious. Let's do the list.
I think people know that try to, you know, have a positive spin on things. You know what I'm saying? And especially lately, last few years, I've opted to stop saying the N-word and the B-word in my music.
Okay.
And so there's just things I'm progressing. Well, because I just don't feel it's necessary. You know what I'm saying? Like the N-word every five bars, you know what I'm saying, that you're, you know, singing on. It's like, And it might be a little bit different in your country, but in the United States, you know, the word has a lot of meaning to it. So,
I think around the world.
You know, yeah, exactly. And so when it's nothing worse than walking into a clothing store and, you know, you're the only brother in there and, like, you know, the people are selling clothes and moving things around and there's Mr. Trap Guy with N-word in the speakers. And I'm like, damn, I'm the only brother in here. What the fuck is going on? And it just feels weird. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So I'm trying to at least contribute, like, yo, you don't have to say that all the time. You know what I'm saying? There's so much more to us that we don't have to go for the gimmick of always saying the N-word every verse.
Next up, Gabriel Garçon Montano performing his numero uno hit, Bombo Fabrica.
Something in the wind. Taste so sweet, time to eat again. A peach bite melody. Mama made it rain. Milk and blood, so the funk is on 10. Never mind enough. I glow for you. I'm in the silo. Silo, oh my God. Brother Silicone's bones. We get something like trampolines. Bombo Fabrica on a roll. Get down gently, gently down the stream as I roll. Eyes blink open and I see all my little thoughts in a row.
Bombo Fabrica is something I read in a Saul Steinberg book. My dad's obsessed with him. And for those who don't know, he's a cartoonist who kind of like went and he blurred the lines between cartoonist and fine artist. And there was like photos of his journal, and in one of them it said Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Bombo Fabrica. And I was like, ooh. Because bombo in Spanish means bass drum, and fabrica is factory. And so I figured, oh, bass drum factory, like that's like my headquarters, like that's like where it all comes from. So that's my song about like the place I inhabit when I'm creating.
I'm in the silo. Oh my God.
I think a lot of my lyrics and the way I create a mood is abstract. And I look to modern songwriters, like I don't know, like people who just like say what's happening, like Frank Ocean, for example, is very direct, almost too direct for me. Like I'm like, why are you saying all that? But I look to that as an inspiration to get out of my head, like I said, and just put my foot down and be more direct.
In school, I was one of those guys that had like a cool crew. You know what I mean? So. I never was like just the thirsty guy. I hate to say like this, I'm being honest. I was always cool.
I don't doubt that for one fucking second.
So it wasn't about like trying to like, you know, I want to be a star. You know what I'm saying? It's like that. Was never like, you know, it just wasn't, you know what I mean? I just was doing music. I played drums first, you know, I had very supportive parents, which they're still alive and doing great. They took me to school and on show and tell, you know, I would play drums on Friday in front of the kids and, you know, and then eventually turned into me playing keyboards and, you know, and then after a while, like I said, I met Leon through my roommate, and Leon Silvers III. He started showing me different things about the game and just kind of letting me know how the business is, letting me know how there's like a lot of people that are involved in it. There's like, you know, people who can make things happen. There's managers, there's promoters, there's like, you know, booking, there's middlemen, you know, people who just like to. I'm timeless.
Whoa!
That's a good answer.
So when I started getting more involved with Leon and everything, I realized, yeah, let me take some meetings. So there would be some meetings, and some of the people at like RCA, like these other labels back in the day, or publishing companies, the cassette tapes that I was making had a lot of hiss on it. So I was making that kind of music in my bedroom. Now that's popular now because it's called lo-fi, you know. But they used to laugh me out of the studio and laugh me out of the, it has too much hiss on it, man. You need to go back and, you know, do something. And so,
but for you, it wasn't intentional. That was just the procedure and the recording.
It was all I had.
The thing that I've spotted with you is obviously you have your albums that are like Moment to Teach His Own and stuff, but you never seem to not have a shortage of music. Like, you'll just put stuff out for free, and then you must be sitting on a fucking mountain of recordings, no? Like,
I say this humbly, I'm sitting on hella shit. You know? I've used this example before. You know, Raj, like, there might be a girl that you might know, or a young lady, and, you know, there's maybe two young ladies that's in your life that you are digging. And one of them is super beautiful. The other one is maybe average, but still very interesting. And the average one is just chilling, but the beautiful one, she's calling you, she's texting you over and over again. Like, can I just get a break? You know what I mean? And it's like kind of like ruining, shit, here's another text from her. And the one is average is like, you know, just like, you're starting to wonder, wow, why doesn't she call? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's the one you're gravitating toward. So I use that analogy because when I had all that stuff on SoundCloud, I was just like, oh yeah, it's just another damn funk song, free. Let me go ride in my car for free. Like, you know, and I'm like, I'm not gonna let you guys do that. You know what I mean? It was too much access.
Comes across, what? Like, it you came make it across sound because thirsty.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And that's what I think that a lot of us musicians out there need to realize, like, just, you know, relax and let people kind of wonder, like, when's the next joint? Or, you know, and that's how Kendrick and a lot of these other cats are doing, you know, they just, or
that's
Eminem,
a moment.
They
it's
wait.
You know, one of the reasons I know you is organized that roller disco we did in LA with Snoop and you, and like, that was a fun party, fun boiler room thing.
Yeah, it was a great time.
What's Snoop like?
Snoop's great. He's a great guy. Very cool. The first song we did, he came over to my house, pulled up in the Porsche, just, you know, chilled, you know what I'm saying? Hit the pavement was the first song.
Yeah.
And I just played the song, and then, you know, oh man, I want that. So he was sitting in the chair just like this, pulled the microphone in front of him, he just spit. And I recorded it, and that was it, you know what I mean? And then we just recorded more and more, and then we got more songs, we just haven't put it out.
Is he one of those doesn't write on a piece of paper kind of guys? He just spit?
He spit, yeah. I don't think he wrote. I think he just spit off the... But I have seen him write. I have seen him with a notepad.
Yeah.
But that night, if I'm not mistaken, you know, I was kind of looking straight ahead because you got to understand, you know, that's one of my heroes
as
well.
You
know what I'm saying? Even though we're the same
yourself,
age, you know what I'm saying? But I look up to, you know, I respect what he's done, you know, when I was working day jobs and I'm listening to Snoop on the radio, and then now he's in my bedroom, which is so surreal, you know what I'm saying? Like, to have him there.
Did you like, smoke a lot?
Oh, you smoked me out, man. Like, you smoked me the fuck out.
You know, when we did that roller disco, I stupidly, just from like putting on rap show, I was like, oh, we should probably get some weed for Snoop. So like, I don't know anyone in LA, we got like a quarter or something of weed. Gave it to his manager when he came in. He looked at me like, motherfucker. He opened up his fucking duffel bag. It was like filled with weed. He's like, do you know where we are and who we're with?
I just gave
a quarter to Snoop. Like, you're just like a fucking idiot.
Thanks everyone for checking out the Boiler Room Chat Room with myself, Dane Funk, and
Raj.
Much love, y'all. Keep up the positivity out there. Don't give up. And don't give up on your dreams. And keep going higher and 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 higher. Much love.